Good morning, everyone, and welcome. So glad to see everybody here. Welcome to especially everybody that's visiting and guests and people listening and watching online from wherever. So again, it's great to be back together here today. And he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right, good. Good to know that everybody knows that. And what a wonderful greeting and what a wonderful reminder that is for all of us. I'm sure we all have many memories of Easter growing up, some good, some maybe a little bit sad, and people that we love and remember, and so many great memories I can think of as a kid, and just how special it was to come and worship together on Sunday morning. The special music, special songs you'd only get to sing maybe once a year, and sometimes you feel like we could sing some of those all throughout the year, but Christ the Lord is risen today is, you know, a little tricky to sing some other mornings, but wonderful memories. I can also remember we would have Easter breakfast at our church, and it was the one day of the year that I got to have chocolate milk, and but those memories, we remember them, and the people often that go along with those, and the people that taught us so much and built up in us, and you know, and I look out and I see, you know, the young people here, and I think of how they're growing up, and they're going to remember these days and continue on the story that we have learned and pass that along to their children as well. Of course, you can see the Easter lilies all around, and in the bulletin it does say who all those are given in remembrance of, and thank you to all of you that have given those, and they definitely are beautiful. And this one right here, this one's just starting to pop out, so beautiful as it is. As far as announcements, there are no evening activities tonight, but just, again, just spend that time with your family and look forward to future times together here. Before we begin, we are going to read just something from Luke 24, and I'll turn to that. If your Bible is handy, you can. I'm going to read from Luke 24, verse 1 through 6, the story of that morning. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen." He is risen. Yes. We are ready to worship together. And if you're able to stand, please stand with us, and we're going to begin with some music.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs on. Alleluia.
Redeeming work is done. Alleluia.
Risen. How about that? How about that?
The Christian faith, if you think about it, the Christian faith is not about principles or ideas or maxims or life hacks. Our faith is a concrete, specific, particular, this, not that, historical faith. That's why you can't prove the Christian faith. Right, if the Christian faith was just about logic and rationality, if you were really smart, you had enough time, and you sat in a room, you could figure it all out. But the Christian faith is not that. It's about what has happened in history, what's happened in time and in space. If there's one thing that's true about whatever happens in history, it wasn't necessary. It didn't have to happen. Right? So creation is an act of God's, something God chose to do. He didn't have to create any of us. But he chose to. Redemption. God didn't have to choose to send Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. He chose to. And he chose to raise his son from the dead. It's an act of history that happened in time and space. The church of the Annunciation in Nazareth, in the grotto, they have a sign, the word became flesh here. Right? It wasn't all that long ago, right? I'm 54, so about 37 of my lifetimes. And if you're 80, about 25 of yours, right? So it actually wasn't all that long ago that this very particular thing happened that changed everything. So as we just sang, we believe in the resurrection. That little word, the, that's really important. We do not believe in resurrection. Right, a lot of people talk about, isn't it great, springtime, it's new life, the tulips are popping, we have one lily that's almost blooming. We think it's COVID, right? So we don't believe in just resurrection, and isn't it great, flowers are coming out. We believe in the resurrection, right? There is an actual particular tomb in Jerusalem, which is now empty, and that has changed everything forever. So let's pray to that God. Father, we thank you. And again, that's too trite. But thank you. It's all we can say is thank you for sending your son to die on the cross for our sins and rising from the dead, so that if we turn from our sin and give it up and repent and put our faith in Jesus, we too, as we just sang, we too will rise again to everlasting life. We do thank you for your love for us, for your blessing us with your jobs and income that we can give to you as a sacrifice of praise at the end of the service. We also thank you for answering our prayers. So we've been praying for Kevin and Janet Pike's grandbabies and the triplets. And we asked that you would have Courtney not go into labor at least until today. And you answered that prayer. And now we're asking for 4 more weeks. We know that each day the odds get better for completely healthy children. So we thank you for listening, not just to our prayers, but prayers around the area from other churches and friends. Thank you for listening to us. And we pray that you would continue to be with these children. And for Matt and Tammy Erste's grandbaby that's coming any day, we pray for a safe delivery for Kayla. For Ed Rounds, who has a kidney surgery next week, we pray that it will be successful and get rid of all of the cancer, at least keeping it located in the bladder. We thank you for friends that are able now, as COVID starts to be waning, to come back and worship with us. We think of Ruth Maxwell, who is here this morning, and Bev Weshi, and Dick and Barb, who came back from Florida. Thank you that they can gather and worship with us again. We also remember those who can't be here, like Jan and Larry, with Jan's positive COVID test, and Theron and Dwanda with their positive test, and Karen and Scott Rosenberger. We know that Scott's has it pretty hard. Thank you that he's got a checked out, but he's having a hard time breathing. He's just exhausted. He's wiped out. I pray you'd encourage him and help him to turn the corner even this day, so Karen and Scott can come back and worship with us as well. So thank you that friends and family can gather on this day to celebrate the weekend that changed everything forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to continue singing our praise to Jesus. Crown him with many crowns.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphs o'er the grave, who rose victorious to the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose again, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. Crown him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit through him given from yonder glorious throne. To thee be endless praise, for thou for us hast done. Be thou, O Lord, through endless space adored and magnified. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. Our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and glory, great things he hath done.
Good morning. As Pastor said this morning, this is an event in history, and we heard earlier the account of one that was there, Luke, And now we get to hear another account from Matthew. And I am reading from Matthew 27:57. Now when evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be given to him. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock, and rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb and departed. And Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary, sitting opposite the tomb. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say to the people, 'He has risen from the dead.' So the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard, so go your way. Make it as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb, with fear and great joy, and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Now while they were going, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priests all the things that had happened. When they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers, saying, "Tell them his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure." So they took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen."
Well, this has been, by all accounts, a very strange year. We've all lost so much, right? Jobs, and so much loneliness and isolation, right? Families that couldn't gather for Christmas, churches that can't gather for fellowship meals. I've heard that the meals here are legendary, and I haven't had one yet, 6 months. We can't even have a fellowship meal, but tentatively we're planning for May. We'll see how this COVID spike works out, but I can't wait so we can gather together normally and not just stay 6 feet apart wearing masks. It's been a really tough time, right? With the virus and then the protest and then the politics, everything's political and everyone disagrees and it feels hopeless. So what a great day for Resurrection Sunday. Because we realize that just how fragile our lives really are, right? We are the most advanced society ever, right? We have indoor plumbing and air conditioning and the internet. We have, and Twitter. We have so much that no one's ever had before. And we can be taken down by something microscopic that isn't even alive. This last year has humbled us. But here's a silver lining. As our supports get stripped away, it reminds us of what we always knew was true. We always knew that our only rock was Jesus. Our only hope was Jesus. But now, maybe for the first time, we feel it. You see, the resurrection proves that Jesus defeats all powers, all enemies. The resurrection defeated Satan, and Satan put the fear of Jesus into the Romans. The Romans feared Jesus because there's this new religion, and if he gets enough followers, he might take away our power, and by the way, he did. The Jews, they feared Jesus because they were the holy ones, the leaders, the Jewish leaders. They were the holy ones. They were devout. And here's this upstart, itinerant preacher who goes around and says bad things about them. He's going to take away our place. And by the way, he did. So these scared Roman and Jewish leaders, they conspired together to not just kill Jesus. There are other ways to kill people you didn't like. They crucified Jesus. And when you crucify Jesus, it was one of the most painful, excruciating deaths that was ever devised, and it was shameful. They took all your clothes away, and then they mocked you. So you read the Gospels, when people were mocking Jesus, that was the cleaned up PG version, right? He was ridiculed. He was shamed. That was the whole point of a crucifixion. You are the dregs of society. You are despicable. And the Jewish leaders, they could not have been more pleased. Because their Bible proved that Jesus was the fraud they had said all along that he was. There is a verse in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 21:23, that says, "Cursed is anyone who hangs on a tree." There you go. He said he was the Messiah. We told you all along he's a blasphemer. God just proved it. He is cursed because how did he die? He hung on a tree. Deuteronomy 21:23. Later, in Galatians 3:13, the Apostle Paul will say, exactly right. He was cursed. He bore our curse in our place. But in the moment, the Jews breathed a sigh of relief. We did it. We won. And these Jewish leaders, they were smart. They thought of everything. They remembered that the disciples said, he's going to rise again. So what happens if the disciples come and steal his body, then tell everyone that he rose again, then they'll get revenge on us. We got to stop that from happening. So they went to Pilate and said, hey, just to close the book on this, can we put a wax seal around the stone and post guards out there, at least for a few days, to keep the disciples from doing this? These leaders had thought of almost everything. Because 3 days later, a bolt of supernatural power jolted the corpse of Jesus awake. His blood-crusted eyelids fluttered, then they opened. Sunlight flooded the tomb through the hole where the door used to be. Jesus heard voices outside and multiple thuds as something heavy hit the ground. He smiled, then used his arms to push apart the strips of linen that bound him. He rolled over and sat up and rubbed the sleep from his eyes. He stood up and stretched and folded the cloth that was around his head and walked out of that tomb. He grinned as he stepped over and around unconscious guards. They were posted to prevent grave robbers. They were not prepared for an inside job. In Matthew 28, what Matt read, these Roman guards, they knew they were in trouble. So they went to the Jewish leaders and said what they gathered, what had happened. And the leaders said, okay, we'll give you money if you promise to say you were sleeping. Now you should know, if you were a Roman guard, if you were caught sleeping on the job, that was a capital offense. They would take off your head. How bad must the truth be when your best defense is, I deserve to die? If that's the story you're going with, what are you hiding? So Jesus defeated Satan and the Romans and the Jews, and he defeats all of our enemies too. Right? What is a big enemy we're all concerned about, or we should be? Death. Right? We don't want to catch the virus because for some people it's really bad. And people have been dying alone this last year. And that's tragic. But you know what's worse than dying alone? Dying, period. I hate dying. There's nothing about dying I like, not even a bit of it. And next week we'll talk more about it in detail, but I'm so glad that Jesus has defeated death. And by the way, Jesus was dead, like you and I someday will be dead unless Christ returns. He was dead. He didn't just die in a moment and come right back to life. He was dead for 3 days. Right? His body was cold and stiff. The soul of Jesus went to the place of the righteous dead, separate from his body. His body was laid out on a cold stone slab for 3 days. He was dead. Not mostly dead. He was all dead. Jesus knows what it's like to die. And in his death, he conquered death. But death is not the worst part of death. The worst part of death is, if you don't know Christ, hell. Right? No one talked more about hell than Jesus. And he said, please don't go there. Gouge out your right eye. Cut off your right arm. Do whatever it takes. Don't go to hell. And Jesus, when he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? That was the eternal Son of God experiencing the wrath of hell in our place. So we don't have to go to hell. It's so unnecessary now since Jesus died and rose again. But even the worst part of hell is not hell. The worst part of death and hell, I think, is sin. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul talks about death and says, the sting of death is sin. The worst part about death and hell is that the Bible says, I deserve it. And so that's why Jesus died and rose again. He bore my guilt in my place. So just so we're clear about this, sometimes we think that the cross is what saves us, and the resurrection, what we're celebrating today, is just God's greatest miracle. It's just proof that the cross took. Right? We were saved by the cross, and the resurrection is just evidence that that really happened. So if Jesus had not risen from the dead, we'd still be saved because he died for us. We just wouldn't have the assurance that we are saved. Right? So we often say we're saved by the cross, and we think the resurrection is just proof. Well, that's not what the Bible says. In Romans 4:25, Paul says Jesus was raised for our justification. That means righteousness, our right standing, our acceptance with God. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17, he says it again. If Jesus has not been raised, we are still in our sins. So here's how this works. When Jesus died, he bore all of our guilt, all of our shame in our place, and that's why he died. Corinthians says, God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us. He died because he bore our guilt and our shame. If he had remained dead, now Jesus never sinned, but our guilt was placed on him. All of the things that we have done that make us fill us with regret and pain and we wince. How could I possibly have said that or done that? That sin, That sin that you're thinking of right now, the one that embarrasses you, humiliates you, that was placed on Jesus. And so he died. If he had remained dead, he would have remained guilty. And so would you. And so would I. But the resurrection, he was raised, Paul says, for our justification, our right standing with God. When the Father raised him, that was the Father exonerating him, releasing him from all that guilt. So he died as our substitute in our place, but he was raised as our representative to establish our place. That's the good news, that Jesus, by dying in our place and rising again, has conquered forever sin, death, hell, and the devil. You know, the devil is an actual person. Demons are actual people. There are people in this world who want you dead. There are people in this world who want your soul. There are people in this world who want to take you to hell. Don't let them get mad at that. That should infuriate you. How dare you hate me that much? What have I ever done to you, demon or Satan? Leave me alone. Well, that's why Jesus died. As Luther said, the devil is God's devil. Satan works for God now. Jesus is in charge of Satan. And that's the main point of Easter. Everything else is gravy, right? The main thing is if Jesus died and rose again in our place, then we just rest in him. We give up trying to clean up. We stop trying to make ourselves feel better about ourselves. We confess what our spouses and kids and parents know about us. We're not always nice people. We deserve to die. We deserve hell. But you know what? We're going to rest in Jesus, who died in our place and rose again. So that's the important point, what Jesus did. This morning, though, I want to focus on, especially given the present crisis in our culture with there's so much with the virus and the politics and everything is personal. There's so much fear and hopelessness. I want to look, if you have your Bibles, meet me in the Gospel of John. John chapter 19. I want to focus on the resurrection of Jesus through the eyes of Joseph and Mary. Not that Joseph, not that Mary. Now at Christmas we talk about Joseph and Mary, right? The parents, well, Mary is the mother of Jesus and Joseph is his earthly father, not his actual father. But in John, John puts together, around the resurrection of Christ, Joseph of Arimathea and Mary Magdalene. These two people could not have been more different. One was an exalted, highbrow Jewish leader, and the other was about as low as you could get. A woman who had seven demons cast out of her by Jesus. And yet these two people, they met in Jesus in John's gospel. They both needed Jesus, and maybe surprisingly, Jesus needed them. So let's read John chapter 19, starting in verse 38. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it, with the spices, in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb, in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Joseph was a prominent member of the Jewish ruling council, the Sanhedrin. So he was very religious. Matthew tells us, the part that Matt read, he's also very rich. And Luke tells us he was upright, upstanding, stand-up guy. And yet, as we just read in John, he was afraid. He sat in the Jewish ruling council as Jesus was tried. We're told in Luke that he did not agree with their decision. So imagine him sitting through that. He must have cringed as the false witnesses came, and everyone knew they were lying, and the charges of blasphemy. And when they spit on Jesus and struck him with their fists, he was a secret follower of Jesus, and yet he didn't have the votes. There was nothing he could do. He had to sit through excruciating and watch the whole thing unfold. And then he watched as they took Jesus out and they crucified him. This wealthy, prominent, very religious man who did follow Jesus watched the dream die. His hope was crucified. There was nothing left to believe. And so this is amazing to me. He had no hope, no room for faith, but you know what? He still had love. He loved his Lord, and he said, is there some way I can express my devotion to him? He had nothing to gain. It was all over now. Tomorrow would be a disaster, but today he would put one foot in front of another. He would do what he could. It was too little, too late. What was the point? And yet, out of love for his Lord, he took Nicodemus, another secret disciple, and somehow they found their courage, because now they're outing themselves, right? They were secret disciples, but now they go to Pilate, the one who crucified Jesus. They said, Pilate, we'd like the body. And Pilate said, yes. And so they went to the cross. And can you imagine? Using a ladder of some type, they gingerly pulled the nails out of the hands, the wrists, the ankles of Jesus. They carefully lowered his body down and wrapped it with spices and linen and laid him in a tomb. Wasn't much. It was all they could do. And yet, have you thought about this? What if they hadn't done that? What if Jesus' body had been left up on the cross like happened with every other crucified victim? You think the good thief and the bad thief, you think someone came and took them down? No, they were left to hang there, and vultures would come and rip out parts of the body. Jackals might come and eat part of the body. If Jesus' body would have been left on the cross, there might have been nothing left to raise from the dead. In fact, Acts 2:27, Peter says, on the day of Pentecost, God promised not to allow his son's body to see decay. And so this entirely hopeless act, it just came from just nothing but love, turned out to be very necessary for our salvation and their salvation too. And so I think, do we have any hopeless situations? I've got a few. Is there someone in our family? Something with our work, something with our finances or a friend that feels entirely hopeless. Like you know you should pray for them or pray for the situation, but it's too far gone. It will make no difference now. Why even bother? Why even try? Well, be encouraged by Joseph of Arimathea. Do what is right, even when you're sure it'll make no difference at all. Because we serve the one who rose from the dead. Amen. And that means there's no person, there's no situation that is as hopeless as you think it is. And then in John 20, we read about Mary Magdalene. Honestly, I wish that this was Mary, Jesus' mother, because it'd be his mom, right? That'd be more precious. My mom is named Mary, and I love her. I think, wow, that would be so great if his mom was there. But it was a different Mary. It's Mary Magdalene. And I thought, well, it must be okay because it's God's word. But also, spiritual family really is supposed to be even tighter than physical, nuclear family. Right, the family that we are building in this church, there's a closeness and intimacy because we are part of the family of God that's even closer than our own mothers and fathers. Jesus said, if it comes to it, you have to deny your own family and then come follow me. So this Mary Magdalene, pretty much the opposite of Joseph. He was wealthy and a religious, upstanding, prominent man. She had, Luke 8 tells us, seven demons cast out of her. This is a woman with issues. She's got a past. But I love how Jesus brings the high and the low together. A devout Jew like Nicodemus would not be caught dead around a demon-possessed person. And even a formerly demon-possessed person, you'd think, okay, you had seven demons cast out of you? What kind of person are you? This is not the kind of person I want to hang around. And yet, Joseph and Mary both converge on the same spot. They're both there watching Jesus die. And Mark 15 says, Mary was there, and she saw Joseph put Jesus in the tomb. And you have to think that in the very first church in Jerusalem, Joseph and Mary would have been worshiping Jesus together. Only Jesus can bring very opposite people together. Mary also must have had some money because she's listed first when lists of women are listed in the Gospels, and she supported Jesus out of her wealth. Luke tells us that she followed Jesus all the way from Galilee to Jerusalem, and then she followed him to the cross, and then to the tomb. She went the whole distance for her Lord. She loved him even when everything seemed lost. And Luke tells us she prepared spices, again, to do what she could and go to anoint Jesus' body. So in John chapter 20, let's read her story. Verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as a cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. So poor Mary, she's so confused. She comes to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body and sees the seal's been broken and the linens are there and the cloth neatly folded. By the way, kids, Jesus rose from the dead and still folded his bed. You can make your bed too. You're not that important. But Mary was not expecting this. In verse 2, she says to Peter, "They've taken the Lord." In verse 13, she'll say to the angel, "They've taken away my Lord." And in verse 15, she'll tell Jesus, "If you've carried him away, tell me where you've taken him." Notice that Mary was not expecting Jesus to rise from the dead. Sometimes we think, oh yeah, this happened 2,000 years ago. These people, they were kind of incredulous. Like, they thought the world was flat, probably, and they were just very gullible. No, her day just got worse. Imagine, she saw her Lord, the one who took demons out of her and gave her life back, the one who was promising to save her and be her Messiah. She just saw him die. The dream had died. It was over. All she could do is go and try and express her devotion, just anoint his body and care for him somehow. And then she comes and finds The body's gone? This could not be worse. These people were not gullible. They were shocked as you and I would be, by the empty tomb. That's why in 1 Corinthians 15, when Paul talks about the resurrection, he lists all the witnesses who saw the risen Lord. And by the way, the resurrection is pretty much the easiest thing in the world to disprove. All you have to do is show the body. And the Jews and the Romans were the most motivated people in the world who would have, they were looking for the body. So the most motivated people had the simplest task, and they failed. What does that tell you about the resurrection of Christ? In verse 11 of John 20, "Now Mary stood outside the tomb, crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, 'Woman, why are you crying?' 'They've taken my Lord away,' she said, 'and I don't know where they've put him.' At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. He asked her, 'Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?' Thinking he was the gardener, she said, 'Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I'll get him.'" The angels, that's a pretty dumb question, isn't it? Why are you crying? Hello, you're in a cemetery. If you see someone in a cemetery and they're crying, don't ask them why they're crying. It's obvious. But then Jesus asked the same question, "Woman, why are you crying?" But followed up with, "Who are you looking for?" Because if you're looking for Jesus, then you shouldn't be crying. There shouldn't be any weeping at the empty tomb. There should be no cry of despair in the one spot that gives hope to the world. There's no crying in baseball, and there's no crying at the empty tomb. Joseph had lost his faith and his hope. All he had left was love. Mary tells us, but love only takes you so far. You do need faith. You do need hope. There must be something to believe in. And she got it with just one word. Verse 16. Jesus said to her, "Mary." Think of that. Jesus announced his resurrection to the world with the name of a woman. And not just any woman, a formerly demon-possessed woman. Jesus sought her out. He didn't go to Peter first, or James first, or John first. Jesus lingered at the tomb knowing Mary would be coming to anoint his body. And he said, "Mary." There is no place in the entire world where women are more respected and loved and elevated than the Christian church. Now, we're sinners, so we haven't always done it right. But following Jesus, just think about it. If you're a woman, where else would you rather be? What other religion takes better care of its women than the Christian faith? Would you want to be a Muslim woman? Or a Hindu woman, or a Buddhist? No, you want to be a Christian woman. In the early church, the Christians cared for the Romans would often put the little girls out on the heap so they would die because they wanted boys. And the church would go and pick up the girls who were left to die and say, we will adopt you and bring you to our family. And historically, the Christian church has led the charge for the rights of women. You might think, well, maybe outside of religion, that's where women do better. Are you paying attention? What has the sexual revolution brought us? men who now say they're women. And women aren't allowed even, shut up, you can't even talk back about that. If you're a woman, you must follow Jesus. There's no one who cares more for you and elevates you than Jesus. In fact, if you look at the church, if you just add up all the Christians in the world, the person most likely to be a Christian today is a woman of color. Women vote with their feet, and they run to Jesus. Jesus sought out Mary. Jesus seeks out you. And he calls your name, Mike, and Russ, Mark, and Carol, and Tiffany. Jesus calls us to save us, and he also needs something from us. Just as Jesus needed something from Joseph. Look at verse 17. Jesus said to Mary, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." So Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. "I've seen the Lord." How do you think she said that? "Guys, I've seen the Lord." Can you imagine how excited she was? We get numb to this, but imagine, "I've seen the Lord." And she told them we had said these things to her. Mary, from that moment on, knew that the world she lived in was not the tragedy she thought it was. But we live in what people would call a comedy, not ha-ha-ha making jokes, but a lightness of spirit. Right? The tomb is empty. Jesus has conquered sin, death, hell, and Satan forever. That means even today, as we live in a culture where there's lack of trust, a lack of faith in institutions and other people, it feels sometimes hopeless, like what's becoming of us? And there's not much love. Yet, the tomb is empty. And no matter what's going on in our families, in our work, in our friends, we can have a lightness about us. We can smile. Yes, we can crack jokes because Jesus is alive. Jesus entrusts his story to you and to me. So it's very simple. If you haven't done it yet, you need to confess your sin. And we all do it regularly, like every day. We all need to confess our sin and put our faith in Jesus. In that way, his death and his resurrection counts for us. And even though we're still sinners and we're still guilty and we're still ashamed of what we've done, we give all that guilt, we give all that shame, we bundle up and we put it all on Jesus, who died and rose again and dispersed it. We now can stand before God clean. And then we gather together like we are right now, and we spread the word. Guys, Jesus is alive. And that changes everything forever. Father, thank you that we have hope. And we have something that we can believe in and give our lives for. Thank you for the many in this church who love you and love your son and love each other. Father, if there's anyone here who is not sure that they know your son, may your spirit who sent Jesus and inspired your word, may your spirit work in their hearts. Draw them to Jesus. We know that when it comes right down to it, the only thing that matters in life is our relationship to a Middle Eastern man. Do we know Jesus? Father, if there's anyone here who's not sure they know your son, don't let them leave without talking to me or someone else so we can lead them to Jesus. May we spread the word that your son is alive, that all of our guilt and all of our shame has been canceled forever. Amen. We'd like to learn a new song. Some of you know this song, so as soon as you think you know it, sing with us. But let's stand and sing Glorious Day. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day, glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing us, my Redeemer is free. Hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day, glorious day. The grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh, glorious day, glorious day, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved, bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried
my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh, glorious day, glorious day.
Believe it? How about that? The tomb is empty. The Lord bless you, and the Lord keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be so gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. May he do it today. Amen. Go in peace.